Welcome back. This is Meet the Press. Greg Combet is our guest. And welcome now to our panel. Karen Middleton from SBS, Jessica Wright from Fairfax. Good morning to both of you.
Good morning, Hugh. Minister, you've got 3 years of a fixed carbon price before you move to a trading system. Now, you can't control the world's financial climate any more than you can control the weather. If you're in a situation where businesses are going under, are feeling too much pressure, how much room is there for you to either tweak the system or give them more money?
Well, let's just step back from that for a second and have a look at the state of the economy. It's growing at 4.3%. Unemployment's around 5%. Interest rates have come down. We're one of the best performing economies in the world. And the outlook for Australian business is strong. Yes, there are pressures in some sectors, in particular in manufacturing, and we have policy settings in place to relieve some of that pressure. But we are in good shape. And the way that we have set this carbon price scheme up takes into account, you know, the state of the economy, and we believe that it is an entirely feasible and economically responsible policy measure.
Well, mind you, at the end of the day, John Howard, when he brought in the GST, said the same thing. He had to tweak it. They had to change their compliance issues for business in particular because there was revolt out there. Are you saying there will be no shift to the carbon price from here, that you're totally locked in on all elements of it?
Well, if some tweaking is justified, of course we'll consider it. But it's been debated for 4 years, essentially, in great detail with the business community, and people understand exactly what it involves in the business community. And we think we've got the settings right, Hugh. And it is an entirely manageable economic reform. And at the end of the day, it's important in the long term because it will help ensure the competitiveness of our economy. And our major trading partners in the Asia-Pacific region are doing similar things and expecting us to do the same.
But you've also got an opposition that says that pledges to repeal this legislation if it wins. The polls are suggesting at the moment that it's in front, well and truly. So business is anticipating the real possibility that this system's only going to be in place for a short time. Isn't that a drawback? Isn't that a problem in terms of getting them to restructure the way you want them to now?
Well, it's a problem for businesses having certainty, but can I state this very clearly? Tony Abbott can't and he won't repeal the carbon price mechanism.
Well, he says he can,
and he will.
This is a
reform. Well, not much that Tony Abbott says is to be believed. He said the coal industry would be destroyed from today. Just have a look about. I'll be visiting a coal mine later today. It's working. I've checked in. Whyalla's still here. He said they'd be wiped off the map. He said there'd be unimaginable price increases, and Coles and Woolies haven't put their prices up. You know, Tony Abbott's not to be believed, and he's about to be found out.
Well, good morning, Minister. But the sun did rise today, but all doom and gloom jokes aside, is it naive to assume that Tony Abbott's campaign against this tax is going to lose any potency in the run-up to the election? You know what a good fear campaign did. You ran Work Choices and that delivered you the 07 election.
Well, Work Choices campaign that I headed up at the ACTU, we ran on facts and on people's lived experience, the actuality of them being sacked in the workplace. We didn't exaggerate a thing, whereas Tony Abbott's been running a fear campaign based on fiction. And now from today, we're moving to factual assessment of his claims. And people in Australia are practical people. They'll test this against their real experience. They'll have heard all the nonsense that's gone on over the last 18 months. They'll now check it against the lived experience, the reality of it. And I think they'll find that Tony Abbott's really been, you know, outrageously misleading and deceitful.
OK, Greg Combet, I'd like to take you on to the other big issue. That's the asylum seeker issue. The impasse is now, the logjam almost completely is almost complete. There is the expert panel now re-examining the whole issue. But whatever they find, Tony Abbott is suggesting it won't shift the parliamentary numbers. Here's what he said.
The coalition doesn't need an expert committee to tell us what our policy is, because we have a policy, and it's a policy that we will stick to.
Minister, what was the point of bringing this legislation in the way you did, with no warning, when you knew everybody's positions were fixed, and really we ended up after 2 days of debate with no change?
Well, everybody's positions weren't fixed. There was quite a significant shift in sentiment in the parliament in the light of the tragic circumstances of so many people losing their lives over the last week or so. And that's why the bill that was put forward, which is a compromise bill put forward by Rob Oatshott, an independent, was ultimately carried through the House of Representatives. Okay. It's because positions did change. But I tell you, I am totally disgusted by the position that Tony Abbott and the Greens took in the Senate to defeat that bill, because it leaves us in a position of not being able to prevent more people being killed at sea in these boats. And that ultimately is the critical test. And Tony Abbott, what we just heard from him in that clip, is his total intransigence, his total aggression, his total negativity, and his total disregard for the consequences of his actions.
But Minister,
and we've got to hold him to account for that.
The fact is here, you've got all the evidence that you need from the opposition and the Greens that Malaysia is out. They're not going to move on this. You're the government. When are you going to bring legislation to the Parliament that has a chance of passing both the House of Representatives and the Senate? Do you think that an inquiry, the people smugglers are going to look at the inquiry and think, that's it, our model's broken, no more boats?
Look, the government shifted its position. The legislation that went through the House of Representatives allows both the Coalition's policy to be implemented and the government's policy to be implemented. We supported an independence bill to shift. You know, we shifted to that position to get that through the Parliament. Andrew Wilkie supported it at the end of the day and, you know, had struggled with his conscience. It's a very difficult issue, but there needs to be movement from the Greens and the Coalition on this issue, because the one really critical test is, what is the policy position that will give the maximum chance of people not dying at sea? And getting this bill that went through the House of Reps, ultimately through the Senate, is important in that regard. I think the Prime Minister has responded very sensibly by now saying, in light of that intransigence, to ask Air Chief Marshal Houston, who is a person of unimpeachable character, and Paris Aristotle, who's well known in this field, and Michael Estrange, a very experienced diplomat, to have a look at these issues and to report to the Parliament what we need to do, because we've really got to get past the politics with this and place some value on people's lives and stop people getting on these boats.
All right, we'll see how much it actually shifts any parliamentary views once they come back with it. We've got Rob Oakeshott coming up next, but Minister Greg Combet, thanks very much for joining us on this day of all days.
Thanks for having me on, Hugh.
Now, David Pope in the Canberra Times captured the asylum seeker debate as it went round in circles.
I think we're starting to gain on them.